Если б знали вы, как мне дороги подмосковные вечера.
Hello, comrades, and welcome back to Ushanka Show, stories about life in the Soviet Union. In today's video, I'll try to answer a couple of questions related to comparison life in the Soviet Union versus life in the post-Soviet republics like Ukraine and Russia. First question came from Professor Javier. Hi, Sergei. I like to read and watch everything about the country of the former Soviet Union. I want to ask, I hope you're willing to answer, which ones do you think people have a better life, when it was Soviet Union or now? A similar question I got from Fancy Crab on Reddit. Well, seeing as you actually lived in the USSR and got to experience it firsthand, what was life actually like? Was it as terrible as most people say, or was it actually a nice place to live? And what was it like compared to modern-day Ukraine? But before I'm gonna try to answer these questions, let me give you an analogy that maybe will help me to explain you what was life in the Soviet Union like. I think the best way to explain life in the Soviet Union is this. Picture a swimming pool, but not a regular swimming pool, but a so-called kiddie pool. It's a very shallow pool that had extremely strict lifeguards. So if you swim in a shallow, like waist-deep pool, are you afraid to drown? Absolutely not. You feel totally safe, right? So this is what Soviet Union provided for its citizens. We felt extremely safe due to heavily subsidized housing. It took less than 10% of average family income. So you never worried about your house being or apartment being taken away. So there was no worries about tomorrow, because tomorrow will be exactly like today, and today is exactly like it was yesterday. So it felt really safe. But how much fun can you find by spending all your life in a shallow pool? What about if you would like to explore the depths? If you like to swim, you can't really do it, right? Of course, for people who don't know how to swim or who don't want to swim, they're perfectly fine in such environment. And that's what a lot of people telling me. How can you complain about life in Soviet Union when housing was cheap? I wish I had, you know, I'm paying 50% of my income for a tiny apartment, and you guys had it almost for free. How can you complain about life in the USSR? And of course, don't forget those strict lifeguards. I mean, I was born in 1971. I lived most of my life under Brezhnev. And then I just had that circus of Andropov, Chernenko, Gorbachev, and no more Soviet Union. But prior to that, you know, if we talk about Stalin era, those lifeguards were extremely strict. I mean, can you imagine getting 10 years in labor camps in Alaska for drawing a caricature of Biden or Trump, or making fun of Biden or Trump, and it'd be called anti-American activity or anti-Soviet activity, was it called in the Soviet Union? And literally, you'll be glad if you get 5 years, but usually you can get up to 10 years for this Article 58. And even I grew up under less strict lifeguards. I was still shocked when I came to America in 1995, so that's the Bill Clinton administration, right? I was truly shocked when I saw the caricatures of Bill Clinton in the local newspaper. I was like, oh my God, they're making fun of their president and no one punished them. It was really, really shocking. I can't find any other word. I was astounded, because it was unheard of to do anything like that back in the Soviet days. So life in this shallow Soviet pool was definitely safe, but extremely boring. And I think that's what explains why alcoholism, that heavy drinking, was such a problem. I mean, to see drunk people almost every evening, just, you know, people finish their shift, then they drink right there at work. They're not like going to the bar, and then they stagger home. And unfortunately, my own father was like that. I mean, he came home drunk every evening. On the weekend, he'll be okay because he'll be with us. But during the week, that was just a normal tradition. Somebody will smuggle a bottle of vodka to the factory, and then after they done with their shift, they shower and they sit down and have split that bottle, have a good drinks, and then they stagger home. And if you think it was bad in the cities, it was even worse out in the country. If you remember, I spent every summer in the village during my summer break, and my goodness, those collective farm workers, the young guys, it was horrible. I mean, they were working drunk, not like even drinking after work. I recall one time we were at the river swimming, and this guy came on his tractor to cool off, and he was so drunk, we literally had to drag him twice out of the river. We saved him from drowning. And then he climbed back in his tractor and drove back to continue harvesting. It's just insane how bad it was with whole drinking issue. But when it comes to the Soviet government, they had a problem because government had monopoly of manufacturing alcohol. So actually, budget was supported by selling vodka, beer, and wine. So we have this expression in Russian language, palka o dvukh konsakh. So it's like a two-sided sword, right? Or double-edged sword. You know, on one hand, productivity was dipping because people were drinking so much. On the other hand, the government was making a lot of money by selling all the alcohol. So when Gorbachev started his anti-drinking campaign and they raised prices, they cut down production, that actually backfired horribly because budget suffered greatly, was way less money coming in, and people who just needed some kind of, I can't call it entertainment, they went for drugs instead of just consuming alcohol. So when we go back to the first question, people had better life, the whole question, what do you consider a better life? I mean, once again, if you don't know how to swim or you don't want to swim, of course you'd prefer that better life in a shallow pool when government kind of, as long as you keep your mouth shut and don't complain, you have a guaranteed, you know, housing and some cheap basic food staples. But for a lot of people, that type of life wasn't good. And of course, for some professions, and we already talked about it, like waitresses or taxi drivers, butchers, and people who work at the warehouses, retail warehouses or the stores, they had amazing life in the Soviet Union because they had access to goods. So yes, for quite a few people, I mean, can you imagine that a waiter in the Soviet Union was making more money than a university professor? So, of course, after the Soviet Union disappeared, things changed drastically and not in a good way for those professions. At the same time, I know several engineers who also worked with my mother at the Research Institute Saturn. And, you know, during the Soviet days, if you were an engineer, it's like a joke because you're one of the smartest guys, but the salaries were just so low that we had a lot of anecdote, a lot of jokes about how poor Soviet engineers are. And those guys benefited greatly. They opened their own private companies. One started doing satellite like TV dishes and just using his experience. Another guy, I don't know what he got into, so they built nice homes on the outskirts of Kiev. They bought several apartments. Their kids went to private colleges. So they did great. So it's like on a case-by-case basis. You can't just tell and, you know, use the white brush and say, oh, everyone's life became so horrible or everyone's lives became great. It depends on the person, depending on the age, and depending on what they used to do, and depending on their attitude. A lot of people were like my father. I mean, he had this deer in a headlight look when everything collapsed and suddenly they stopped paying him money at the factory, but he still was going to work even without pay. He never bothered to start looking for different opportunities, although he was fantastic spray painter. I mean, he could just go to your garage and with this just basic equipment, he could paint spray your car like factory perfect finish. But he never cared about maybe trying to open his own little company, you know, start doing like a body shop. Nope, he just went back to that factory, even they didn't pay him, you know, salary for months, and that's how he just worked till he retired. In the same time, my mother, for example, she was a totally different person. She had quite more this entrepreneurship attitude. She began cooking, making pies and sell them by the subway station. And she did it for many years instead of going to her place of work where they also stopped paying salaries. It was a huge issue, was just cash flow in the country. I'm talking about Ukraine. So she's just like, oh, I'll try to do that. And she was a good cook. She always looked clean and neat. So people trusted her to buy on the street. And she was making like those, they call it piroshki, pierogi, you know, stuff with cabbage or meat. And she did great for many years until it became illegal to do street, you know, selling food like that without license. And of course, Comrade Sergei, I benefited the most from the collapse of the Soviet Union. I mean, I was pretty much a kid most of my life in the USSR. I was only 20 in 1991, but I was able to travel to the other countries. I did the right thing. I didn't start doing drugs, you know, or got into drinking. I was studying English. I was helping people to smuggle vodka to Poland and got paid $20 per three-day trip. It was a good money back in early 90s. I was buying wholesale instant coffee at some warehouse and then sell it retail on the street. I mean, maybe one day I'll make a video about all the crazy stuff I was doing, you know, traveling to St. Petersburg, or Leningrad at that time, with the load of garlic. Took a load of sausages to Gomel, Belarus. It wasn't fun, but, you know, I didn't just give up and just started doing stupid things like drugs or alcohol. I was learning English, and in the end, you know, here I am here in Michigan running Ushanka Show. And another thing I was thinking that, you know, when they interview people on the street and ask them, you know, they pick the older people, of course, in their 60s, 70s, and they ask questions, well, do you miss USSR? Is your life better or worse in modern Russia or Ukraine? You know, people who made it, they don't walk the streets these days in the cities. They drive cars. So if you want to get the more balanced picture besides street interviews, you need to maybe go somewhere by the supermarket and talk to people who drive cars and see how they're doing. Because if you look at the old photos of Kiev or Moscow, Leningrad, you could see there's hardly any cars on the streets. We never had issues with traffic. And now it's completely different. Every street is packed, jammed, tied with cars. So who are those people who drive those cars? There's millions of people in Russia, Ukraine that actually doing way better now than they did under the Soviet Union. But, you know, I don't know why no one interviews them. But for the people who didn't make it through this change and remained poor, I think the main difference is during the Soviet days, Soviet Union was a comfortable place to be poor. We pretty much all were poor. We could barely afford anything, but since we didn't need to worry about housing and some basic foodstuffs, it was comfortable to be poor in the Soviet Union. Annoying, but comfortable is that you didn't have to worry. Now, it's not comfortable in Russia or Ukraine to be poor. They can take away your apartment. You know, some people get into debt. So that's, I think, the main difference between lifestyles there and now. When you talk about better life, if you remained poor, you were more comfortable in the Soviet Union being poor. If you made it, of course, you enjoy your life more now since you have all those things that you couldn't have during the Soviet days. Well, that's all I have for you today. I hope you enjoyed this video, maybe learned something new. As always, please don't forget to like it. share with your friends, and we'll talk to you soon. До свидания. Goodbye.
By the way, the cool merch for Cool Comrades is available at the Ushanka store at teespring.com.
Just a friendly reminder that my book American Diaries is available on amazon.com, or shoot me an email if you would like to have a signed copy. Thank you!
And if you love my channel and would like to show your support, please click on the link below this video and become the patron of the Ushanka show. For as little as $1, you can help us grow and create the new interesting videos about the life in Soviet Union.